call it the summer of romance, I guess. Few things distract me and entertain me better than a good romance anime, and this summer's anime season had plenty of them. Of the 6 shows that I ended up finishing, you can classify 4 of them as romances, and one of them with strong romantic elements, even though it's not really a rom-com. And while there was no show that I absolutely loved from this season, I think that I can say very nice things about all the shows that I finished. Which is better than I can say for most seasons, even the preceding season that I called my favorite season of anime ever. So let's get into it. Shoshimin features our 2 heroes entering their first year of high school, aiming to shed their previous reputations and aiming to become what they call ordinary. One is our sweets loving girl Osanai, who looks to shed off a violent past. And 2 is our pensive but brilliant Kobato, who likes to solve mundane mysteries but doesn't like all the attention that comes with the solving of those mysteries. Shoshimin was the show that I looked forward to the most at the beginning of the season. A, because it looks so gorgeous from all of its previews, but B, because the original story comes from the writer of Hyoka, a story adapted by Kyoto Animation and turned into one of the most beloved mystery shows of all time, and one that I personally give a 10 out of 10. And on the surface, Shoshimin shares a lot in common with Hyoka. Kobato is our Sherlock Holmes type, and Osanai is a quiet tag-along, well, at least at first. And they are both better together than they are apart. Even if Kobato and Osanai have no romantic subtext like Hotaro and Chitanda do in Hyoka. Shoshimin also likes to investigate the mysterious aspects of truly mundane things, like Kobato spending an entire episode trying to figure out how a cup of hot cocoa was made, and Osanai's sweet tooth accidentally starting a fight amongst all the members of the Wall Newspaper Club. And even though there are categorical differences between these 2 shows, the spirit of Hyoka is alive and well in Shoshimin. Just one problem, though. Shoshimin is pretty boring. Most of the time, anyway. I can't really put my finger as to why, as I think that Shoshimin's story actually might be more engaging than that of Hyoka. And I don't really want to reduce this to, well, Kyoto Animation was the one that did Hyoka, and a studio that you've probably never heard of is the one doing Shoshimin. Especially because Studio Lapin Track absolutely kills it on the visuals and the audio here. But maybe there really is something with how Kyoto Animation approaches storytelling, because most of Shoshimin is a pretty loud snooze fest for me. Which is really too bad, because I can imagine a lot of fans obsessing over the details of the show like they do for Hyoka. And I have to admit that the OP is killer and the ending is probably going to end up my favorite of the year. But in all honesty, I was hoping for Hyoka, and I think this show was also aiming to be Hyoka, but Hyoka, unfortunately, this is not. 6 out of 10. Alia, Sometimes Hides Her Feeling in Russian, is a standard rom-com about our Russian transfer girl Alia in love with our Japanese-born boy Kuze. Except Alia is popular and cool and mysterious, and so she doesn't reveal her true romantic feelings for Kuze except when she's talking to herself in her native Russian. Which she doesn't know our boy Kuze can understand. Misunderstandings and hijinks ensue. If my anime list was any indication, then this was an incredibly popular show. Ranked 2nd in users this season only to Oshinoko, which I will get to. And after watching Alia all the way through, its popularity makes a lot of sense. Alia is a competent rom-com with appealing character designs and a decent enough hook. It does all the high school rom-com things pretty well, even if there's not one thing that I think it does exceptionally well. And yes, I know I am not its target audience of lonely and horny teenage boys. But if you're just looking for a basic high school rom-com, you could do a lot worse than Alia. Ironically, I think this show's biggest shortcoming is when it tries to become something a little more elevated than a basic high school rom-com, especially with our main boy, Kuze. Giving Kuze dimension and a semi-tragic backstory makes a lot of sense on paper, and it certainly makes him more interesting than the mostly boring male leads we get from these types of shows. But then the show doesn't really do anything with his backstory besides support all the sitcom elements, choosing instead to lean into its weird, horny bits and the mediocre jokes. You know, now that I think about it, Alia's biggest deficiency as a high school rom-com is that it's not very funny. But at least it isn't cringeworthy when it attempts its jokes like a show like, say, Rent-A-Girlfriend, as much as I defend that show in general. But even if the jokes hit harder and its backstory was explored with a bit more proficiency, I'm not sure that Alia would have ever evolved into something more than a pretty good high school rom-com. But in that way, it absolutely succeeds, even if I'm going to forget everything about it by next week. 7 out of 10. Futakire, or Love Is Not Indivisible by Twins, is a high school rom-com that features our 2 fraternal twin girls in love with their neighbor boy, Shun. the older twin Rumi, a basketball-playing tomboy who dates Shun first, and the younger twin Naori, a whip-smart girly girl who dates Shun second, though both end up dumping him for reasons. Yeah, this is a messy rom-com, and I mean that in the best way possible. Because Futakira shows good tonal balance aiming for both a joshi audience and a seinen audience, though probably leaning more towards the seinen audience considering all the male wish fulfillment in this show. Futakira is a rom-com that presents a more adult understanding of romance and at least acknowledges things like sex. Though notice I said a more adult understanding and not a more mature understanding because these are still high school kids after all. And the drama here is very high school, which means it's sometimes cringy, but it's also very delicious. Futakira hooked me immediately in its opening episode with how juicy its drama is, in a way that only shows like Scum's Wish have done for me before. Futakira's love triangle is also reminiscent of that of Touch, Adachi Mitsuru's 1980s masterpiece. Even if the twins falling in love with their neighbor's storyline is a bit more of a trope than I realize. But my overarching point is that Futakira's story and drama and emotional resonance are all top-notch. However, I do have two pretty strong gripes with this show. One is the visual presentation, which is straight up not good. This seems to be the first full-length project from the studio World 2, and so in that case, I guess it gets a pass. But I also wouldn't blame anyone for being turned off by this show immediately upon watching it. It looks that bad. Anime is a visual medium after all, and if the visuals are bad, then you can pretty easily classify the show as bad as well. My second gripe with this show is the insane and frankly absurd volume of media references. I've already pointed this out in various Tumblr posts and even in my mid-season video, but it's a point that I really, really want to hammer home. These kids are way too media literate for their age. Every episode features our heroes making at least half a dozen references to old American TV shows and books and movies in a way that no 15-year-old could possibly know, no matter how much of their parents' media they consume. I suspect this aspect of the story is just the original author showing off how much Western media they've taken in their lifetime, which can be fun if used ironically, but in this instance, it feels too sincere to be enjoyable. That doesn't ruin the show for me, but there are so many instances where I'm watching these episodes where I'm like, all right, do I really need to know how much you like Star Trek? Which is too bad because I think at its core, Futakira is a really enjoyable story, all the issues notwithstanding. And perhaps in the hands of a more experienced team and with some major edits on the story side, it could have ended up a lot stronger. But still, this seems to be a decent first crack for what seems to be a brand new studio. So I'll give it a 7 out of 10. So going forward, any one of the three shows that I'm going to be talking about next, I would be happy to call my favorite of the season. All of them are great shows with solid points in their favor. And they also have glaring issues that don't make them obvious number one choices. I'm gonna order them still because I'm American and I don't believe in ties. But if either of the two shows that precede my top choice was actually your favorite of the season, you can just call it mine too. I totally support that sort of headcanoning. Gigi Harem, or Pseudo Harem, features our high school age actor Rin falling in love with her theater club senpai Eiji. And when Rin figures out that Eiji has always wanted to be the center of a harem, she teases him by consistently performing all of the harem tropes as her way of flirting. Gigi Harem looks very basic and doesn't really do anything special, and also might be the best rom-com of the year. The show starts off as a will they, won't they, only very clearly without the won't they part because there's nothing really getting in the way of our couple's eventual pairing. And in a lesser show, this might be a problem because most stories need conflict to stand upright. But Gigi Harem gets away with having no conflict by just being so goddamn adorable. Eiji is a gem of a lad that deserves all of the attention that he gets from Rin. And Rin is so bubbly and playful, it's really hard not to root for her. I especially love rom-coms where it's obvious why the two characters getting together are getting together, and not just hot girl meets plain boy like we see in most high school rom-coms. The first half of the show is their high school experience. They pair up midway through the show, and then the second half of the show is a speed run through the rest of their relationship up until their wedding. Sort of like Clannad After Story, though not nearly as sad. And if there's any place I think the show falls off a bit, I think it's here. Not because I don't think it's worthwhile to explore what this relationship would have looked like post-graduation, but because this show doesn't do much character development at all, and so the end of the show just kind of feels like the two high schoolers we met in the beginning of the show getting married a few years later. But that's a small quibble because everything else about this show, blocky backgrounds notwithstanding, is pretty excellent. What Gigi Haram seems to understand about acting and playing is that these actions can be used as proxies to simulate real life experiences. When Rin and Eiji play around as high schoolers, they're kind of testing the waters for what a relationship with the other person would be like. And as someone who did a lot of theater in high school and college, I think that's the best example of what theater can give to an individual. That's really beautiful, and I think it leaves a wonderful message for eccentric or performative kids to take away. That play is not just play, it's a supremely important part of our lives. Gigi Haram is the darling of this season, and likely the most wholesome and sweet high school rom-com you will ever watch, which is wild for a show with harem in the title. 8 out of 10. Oshinoko's second season features our teenaged heroes in a more advanced part of their entertainment careers, most notably in the season's first 9 or so episodes, which focus on a stage adaptation of an in-universe manga named Tokyo Blade. The play features Aqua, Kana, and Akane in important roles, as well as some tertiary characters in more primary roles, in the play, of course. Even though it was a gigantic success, I was not such a big fan of Oshinoko's first season. I thought it had solid things going for it, most notably the animation. But it was also kind of overdone and way too serious with its subject matter, which is admittedly pretty serious. But it did enough for me in the first season to make me curious about the second season, and I was immediately sold within the first few minutes of the first episode, which is a minutes-long still long shot of a theater audience watching the opening scenes of Tokyo Blade. Being somewhat of a theater geek myself, I was super excited to see the direction of the second season of Oshinoko, especially when the first few episodes create a conflict between the theater director's interpretation of the manga and the original author's insistence on textual originalism. It's just so theory-heavy and dense. And to the show's credit, it finds a cool way to resolve this conflict in the beginning to middle portion of the season, by pairing our genius but antisocial mangaka with various elders that show her the true path of wisdom. But the road that it takes to get there is a little winding and annoying. Okay, so if you follow my Tumblr blog, which you probably don't, you will know that most of the posts I've made over the past 3 months have been complaining about this show in particular. And I won't go through all of my complaints, but I'll go through my biggest one because I want to make a bigger point out of it. My gripe with how this show sides with theatrical interpretation starts with everybody eventually siding on the idea of show don't tell, which is a key element of strong storytelling. But this show gets weighed down by so much exposition about this concept in particular that the messaging gets trampled by needless narration. Or in other words, Oshinoko does a lot of telling about how important it is to show, not tell. Which I don't think is necessarily the fault of the show, because one of Oshinoko's biggest challenges is its mass appeal to a general audience. Which means that even if it wants to box with heavy concepts, it needs to do so with kid gloves, so that all the preteens and the normies in the audience can understand what's going on. And we see this sort of hedging all throughout the show. All of our young and beautiful characters really struggle with romantic feelings, but there's barely hint of any sex in this show to keep it PG, most likely. Our flashbacks with young Kana and young Akane featured them with far more advanced vocabularies than any 5-year-old should have, just to make sure that we in the audience all understand the trauma that these kids are suffering in the moment. And we spend way too much time in the heads of our characters, especially when all they're really doing is recapping the scene that we just watched. I could go on for a while because I have a lot of gripes about this show, but only because you can only complain about the ones you actually love, and I really, really want to love Oshinoko. The visuals, the character design, the action animation, it is all stunning, and something you would only see in like a big production shonen like One Punch Man or Mob Psycho. And definitely not on a heady meditation of the Japanese entertainment industry. I also think this season has a much more focused and nuanced approach to the entertainment industry itself, whereas the first season just kind of does like a quick tour of surface level industry tragedies. And maybe my favorite part of this season is the character development we get from Akane and Kana in particular. So much so that I wish this show was just about Kana and Akane and not about Aqua and Ruby. So those are my key takeaways for what is easily the biggest and most beloved show of the summer season. I think Oshinoko gives us plenty of reasons to love it, and if I was 14 years old and auditioning for my high school's rendition of Pippin, then yeah, I would love it to death. But unfortunately, I'm a little older and more jaded, so those parts of Oshinoko just don't really do it for me, despite it doing so many incredible things. You can give it a 10 out of 10 if you wish. I wouldn't blame you if you did, but for me, it's a light 8 out of 10. And that leaves us with only one. So without any further ado, my favorite show of the 2024 summer season is Makeine. Makeine: Too Many Losing Heroines is about our plain high school age shoujo manga loving boy Nukumizu, whose strong knowledge of various shoujo manga tropes allows him to befriend three quote-unquote losing heroines, or girls who are rejected by their primary crushes. And the show kind of sells itself as what happens to these girls once the main couple gets together. Sort of like a Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are dead situation, though without the existential dread. Before I get started with this review in earnest, I just want to say that Makeine has no business being as good as it is. The story is not interesting, the animation style is pretty standard, and our boy just doesn't have a lot going for him. Besides shoujo manga, the thing that he geeks out for is literally tap water. Tap water. But besides this, Makeine succeeds in kind of an opposite way that Gigi Harem succeeds, where Gigi Harem has a really fun story and delightful characters that overshadow the show's poor production value. Makeine just throws production value at its audience, hoping to distract us from the hollowness of the show. And you know what? It works. The animation quality on this silly little rom-com is insane. The character design is delightful, the school's campus looks incredible, and we go to so many fun restaurants and natural scenes and shopping centers throughout this show. And the production quality succeeds beyond its visuals. From its frenetic third wave ska OP to its sweeping score, Makeine really nails the audio side of the show. And we haven't even gotten to the vocal performances. Specifically for Yanami and Komari, these are two of the best vocal performances I have ever heard in any show. The emotional switches, the comedic timing, the vocal range, it is just a treat to hear these actors perform. And it certainly helps that Makaine's writing is sharp and funny and exceptionally emotional when you least expect it. Alright, so that's all the good stuff about Makeine, and there's a lot of it. And even though my list of gripes with the show is short, there's one pretty big one. And that's that Makeine has basically zero narrative focus. I can tell you what individual episodes are about, but I can't really tell you what the show in its entirety is about. Because this show actually feels like a loosely connected series of vignettes pretending to be a cohesive show. And while there's nothing wrong with this sort of approach, it's kind of disappointing to see how loose and sloppy the storytelling is, considering how tightly executed everything else in the show is. Its storyline and overall theme are the things that are holding me back from considering Makeine as literally one of the best rom-coms of all time. But it's otherwise pretty excellent, and I don't think there's any shame with calling it the best show of a season that also includes Oshinoko. Makeine is a fun show with a big heart and a lot of reasons to make you smile. It is a strong 8 out of 10 and the best show of the summer 2024 season. I'm gonna stand it right there.